Today I'll be speaking about the management of alcohol withdrawal, the simple withdrawal part of it. So I declare no conflicts of interest. So today's learning objectives, when I'm talking about the assessment of alcohol withdrawal simple, initially I would like to talk about what is withdrawal. Now when we're talking about withdrawal here, today I'm talking mainly about alcohol related withdrawal. I'll briefly talk about neurobiology of withdrawal, also the timeline, established timeline, as well as identification of symptoms of withdrawal, assessment of the simple withdrawal, as well as management, especially the detoxification phase of it. Now, while diagnosing substance use disorder, if we look at different criteria in DSM as well as ICD, we know that the all symptoms can be clustered into four groups. Symptoms of impaired control, symptoms of social impairment, symptoms of risky use, and the pharmacological criteria. Now, especially when we are talking about pharmacological, which is actually a biological criteria, we talk about use despite knowledge of harm, which is either physiological or physical or mental. We talk about tolerance, and finally we talk about withdrawal symptoms. Now, all these criteria are mainly pharmacological criteria. Now, what is withdrawal? Withdrawal is, by definition, it is the development of substance-specific maladaptive behavioral change, which is usually associated with uncomfortable physiological and cognitive consequences, which is the result of cessation of or reduction in heavy and prolonged substance use. Now, there are different parts of this definition. That first thing that you need to know, that is, it is substance specific. Every substance will have its own withdrawal. It will proceed in particular phases of withdrawal, as I'll talk about alcohol very soon. You need to understand that the signs and symptoms of withdrawal are opposite to the substance direct effect. So if alcohol, being a depressant drug, which acts as a depressant in the brain, its symptoms of withdrawal will be that of excitation or that of agitation. If a substance is a stimulant, the withdrawal effects will be that of dysphoria or depression. The onset of these symptoms, the duration for which the withdrawal lasts, as well as the intensity of these symptoms or the severity, they are different in different people and also depend on the agent that is used. Also, the duration for which a particular agent is used, as well as the degree or the amount of the neuroadaptation that happens in the brain. Now, neurobiology, how these changes occur over time. Now, over the period of time, we have seen, it has been seen in research, that low ethanol, that initial low quantity of alcohol, leads to glutamate binding to glutamate receptor, which causes the feelings of euphoria and excitation. Now, over the period of time, when there is a chronic and higher quantity of ethanol, that ethanol potentiates the GABAergic effects, which is actually a negative or a depressant effects of alcohol, which leads to further disinhibition and intoxication related symptoms. Now, prolonged use. Now, you can see that initially it is glutamate binding, and later it is potentiation of GABA. So prolonged alcohol use will downregulate. After prolonged use, there will be downregulation of GABA receptors and increased expression of NMDA receptors, because that is inhibited with prolonged use. So the receptors will increase with production of more and more glutamate, which will not function. However, after abrupt cessation, because there is more of glutamate receptors that are available, that will cause CNS excitation, which will later result to autonomic hyperactivity and subsequent neuropsychiatric complications like seizures as well as delirium. There is also chronic use of ethanol is known to cause increased dopamine in the reward system. However, increased dopamine also during the withdrawal cause autonomic hyperarousal as well as psychotic symptoms like hallucinations. Now, this is briefly. So during intoxication, you see that GABA is increased, epinephrine is increased, glutamate is decreased. However, in the withdrawal, GABA activity is decreased, which causes anxiety, insomnia, and seizures. Glutamate is increased, which causes delirium as well as seizures. Now, alcohol withdrawal symptoms, when we are talking about the various, it's a cluster of various symptoms, which can be clustered under these four domains, that are autonomic symptoms, motor symptoms, symptoms of awareness, as well as psychiatric symptoms. Autonomic symptoms that are generally seen mainly in the initial period of the withdrawal, which are characterized by tachycardia, that is increased heart rate. Sometimes there can be increased breath rate or respiratory rate also, that is tachypnea. There can be dilation of pupils, which is also sometimes seen during very high intoxication. There will be increase in blood pressure, elevation of body temperature, which manifests as fever. There can be diaphoresis, that is profuse sweating. There can be symptoms of autonomic arousal of GI system, that is nausea as well as vomiting, as well as diarrhea, or a churning sensation in the abdomen is what people complain of. Other domain of symptoms is the motor symptoms, which is manifested by hand tremors, tremulousness. Seizures is also considered as motoric component of seizures. There can be gait disturbances like ataxia. There can also be hyperreflexia as well as difficulty in talking, that is dysarthria, during withdrawal symptoms. Symptoms of awareness, that is awareness of the surroundings, which can manifest as insomnia, a difficulty in falling asleep. Agitation, irritability, as well as in severe kind of withdrawal, there can be delirium as well as disorientation. In case of psychiatric symptoms, there is a host of symptoms that is present during withdrawal. Initially, there can be anxiety, irritability. And in the later periods, there can be frank psychotic symptoms like illusions, delusions, hallucinations, which are mainly visual and also auditory. There can be lability of the mood, that is affective instability. Patient can become very disinhibited during withdrawal and also may become very aggressive or combative. Now, this is from the Morsley Prescribing Guidelines, which is a very famous book, which talks about the timeline of symptoms. Now, this is relatively more important and more established in case of alcohol, because most of the cases that we see of alcohol abuse, we are mainly looking at abuse of ethanol. Unlike other substances like benzodiazepines, where there is a host of substances which act on different receptors for different durations of time, even opioids can, there are so many types of opioids, synthetic opioids, natural opioids, which act for different times. However, when you're talking of alcohol, this timeline is more or less kind of fixed. So this is the symptoms. These are the symptoms that we can expect when we are seeing a patient. And once there is a withdrawal, cessation, or decrease in the amount of alcohol, this is how the manifestations happen. So initially, between 3 to 12 hours where these symptoms occur, they are agitation, there can be anxiety or irritability, there can be different motoric symptoms like tremors of hands, tongues or eyelids, there can be profuse sweating, there can be GI symptoms like nausea, vomiting, there can be increased body temperature, there can be symptoms like increased blood pressure, increased heart rate, as well as general feeling of malaise. Now, generally, it is seen from 3 to 12 hours when it starts. It peaks at around a day or two, and it can last for some people up to 14 days. Now, an untreated withdrawal can last for 7 to 10 days is what people say. However, certain symptoms like tremors or sleeplessness can last for months together. Now, this is something that will be taken care of in the next session. This is regarding severe withdrawal, where generalized seizures happen, which generally are seen between onset at the time of 12 to 18 hours, as well as delirium tremens, which is a combination of delirium, autonomic arousal, and perceptual disturbances, which happens at around 3rd to 4th day. Now, both of these conditions have a very high morbidity as well as mortality. Now, this is what I have already spoken about. So, mild withdrawal symptoms start at about 6 to 36 hours. Hallucinations is something that I would like to talk about. I'm not sure how much it will be covered in the next session. Hallucinations happen at around 12 to 48 hours. Now, during this period, now it is differentiated from delirium tremens by a lack of delirium. That is, there is clear consciousness or the mental status is intact. Vital signs are also relatively normal. Now, these hallucinations are generally visual hallucinations. People talk about very classic Lilliputian hallucinations or hallucinations involving various animals. There can be auditory as well as tactile hallucinations also, but these are mainly commonly seen in case of delirium tremens, where there is also a loss of awareness of the surroundings. It generally resolves within 48 hours and even before the proper delirium tremens starts. Now, what are the risk factors of alcohol withdrawal? If the patient has had very severe alcohol dependence. Now, if you have seen the various scales that Dr. Prabhat has talked about, scales like audit. If the person has very severe alcohol dependence, he is more likely to have a very severe withdrawal. If a person goes through this withdrawal period with self-detoxification without any proper medical input, the person may have very severe withdrawal in the future. Multiple previous admissions for alcohol withdrawal, concurrent medical illnesses, including illnesses of liver, heart, or even neurological illnesses. Previous history of delirium tremens and alcohol withdrawal seizures are very important because they are kind of harbingers of future episodes of delirium tremens or alcohol withdrawal seizures. Now, this is something that I just spoke about, that the hallucinations during withdrawal can be visual, auditory, or tactile. People talk about in the initial period lights being too bright, sounds being too loud, as well as some tactile sensations like pins and needle sensations. Visual hallucinations are more common, frequently involving some animal. Auditory are mainly not exactly the words, but unformed sounds, that is the elementary auditory hallucinations. Tactile hallucinations like bugs under the skin, or formication as they are called, are also common. This is assessment. This is mainly we are talking about CIVA AR. I'm not sure how much it is visible, but it will. These slides must have been shared with you. So CIVA AR is a 10 item instrument which is commonly used. It is free of cost. Is not copyrighted. The score is generally 10 items out of 10 items, 9 items score of about 7. Only orientation item has a score of 4. So total items consisting score of 67. What is generally spoken about is mild, moderate, and severe withdrawal. So mild, moderate is score of up to 8. 9 to 19 score is moderate withdrawal, and more than 19 score is that of severe withdrawal. However, Maudsley prescribing guideline says that if the score is more than 10, that's a good enough indication that the person needs an assisted withdrawal or an withdrawal with the help of medications. Now, various items in the scale are nausea, vomiting, tremor, paroxysmal sweats, tactile disturbances, auditory disturbances, visual disturbances, anxiety, agitation, headache or fullness in head, as well as orientation and clouding of sensoria. Though we also mention, if you see on the top left, we also mention patient's name, date, time when it is checked, as well as pulse or heart rate, however, as well as blood pressure. However, those items are not included in the scoring. So the answer to that particular Slido question was pulse rate, which was option C. There are certain other scales. This is one of the another scales, the short alcohol withdrawal scale, also called as SAWS. It is also a 10 item scale. Each item scored from 0 to 3, total score of about 30. The scores of more than 12 are, if they are there, you should consider a medically assisted withdrawal. Now, which are the patients which are taken up for outpatient withdrawal, and which are the patients who should be admitted and should be given an inpatient withdrawal management? So outpatient withdrawal or outpatient therapy is mainly considered for patients who are able to follow instructions, patients who are willing to commit to daily visits or very frequent follow-up visits, if they have a supervising carer who can take care of the medication compliance. The treatment as well as contingency plan should be agreed about. That is, the treatment, how treatment should be given, as well as if the treatment fails or if there is certain other problems that come, what should be done. So a contingency plan should also be agreed upon with the patient, with the caregiver, as well as the general physician if you are referring the patient to a general physician. In case of complicated withdrawal, I'll talk about it later, it is generally advisable to give an inpatient withdrawal management or inpatient assisted detoxification. In case of head injury also, it is more feasible to give an inpatient management. If a patient is not pregnant, you can consider an outpatient withdrawal and not having any unstable medical comorbidity. Now, all these cases with severe alcohol withdrawal, with history of seizures or delirium tremens, that is a complicated withdrawal in the past, with patients with extremes of ages, two young patients or two old patients who are very fragile, concurrent use of other substances like benzodiazepine should generally be treated as an inpatient. Comorbid mental as well as physical illnesses. So there may be problems with the cognition, there may be learning disabilities, and people may not be able to follow the instructions. They should generally be monitored and should be given an inpatient therapy. Pregnant patients, patients with poor social support where medication compliance as well as medication availability may be poor, as well as history of failed previous OP or outpatient treatments should be admitted and given an inpatient withdrawal management. Now coming to management, we'll be mainly focusing on the detoxification. Benzodiazepines are of course the treatment of choice for the management. Generally preferred if the patient's general condition is good, we can consider long acting agents which are supposed to be good because of their low abuse liability. Agents that are generally used are diazepam as well as chlordiazepoxide. In case of patients with poor liver functions or deranged liver functions, as previous case was discussed, lorazepam or oxazepam are the agents of choice because of their shorter half-life. Generally, these benzodiazepines should not be given for too long a period and should be tapered and stopped over the period of 5 to 7 days. However, they can be given for longer periods in a case of a complicated withdrawal or previous history of a patient requiring larger doses of benzodiazepines. Patients should be monitored very closely. Even when they are outpatient, they should be called frequently for the follow-ups for any excessive drowsiness or any possible side effects of the medications. as well as you should not be forgetting about thiamine. Now, thiamine is generally spoken about in cases of severe withdrawal or patients with delirium tremens, which are more susceptible to development of Wernicke's encephalopathy, Korsakoff of psychosis, as well as people with poor nutritional support with multivitamins in cases of pellagra encephalopathy. However, even in cases of simple withdrawal, we can always prescribe patients with thiamine about 100 milligrams twice daily. In case of patients with poor nutritional intake or absorption, a higher dose of parenteral thiamine should be considered. Now, these are the following a few of the don'ts: that do not start detoxification if the patient is already very severely intoxicated. That is, his blood alcohol concentration may be measured by breath alcohol concentration by a breath analyzer. It's very high, or it is still rising as you are checking the patient or monitoring patient. It should be contraindicated for patient with subsequent ongoing use of alcohol, that you are not sure whether patient is very motivated or whether he'll go and again have a drink. It can cause, because both alcohol as well as benzodiazepine act on the same GABA receptors, there can be a risk of respiratory depression. You should not be continuing benzodiazepines for long term, more than 10 days, unless indicated otherwise in case of severe withdrawal. Now, detoxification regimes that are generally followed, there are three types of regimes. First is fixed dose reduction, which is generally something that is given in OP-based care. Here, generally what is done is, based on the intake of the patient, number of units the patient takes daily, based on that, a benzodiazepine dose is given and it is tapered and stopped over the period of 5 to 7 days. General calculation as a rule is, 1 unit of alcohol is equivalent to about 1 milligram of lorazepam, which is almost equivalent to 5 to 10 milligrams of diazepam. So a cumulative dose is calculated and given into divided doses over the period of 5 to 7 days. This is fixed dose reduction. There is something called a symptom triggered regimen, which is generally for inpatient care or patients with where monitoring is possible. Variable dose reduction is when a patient, based on his symptoms of withdrawal, as assessed by previously told withdrawal instruments, withdrawal assessment instruments, we should be assessing the patients every 1 to 2 hours, and based on the withdrawal symptoms, we can give them a dose of diazepam or lorazepam. And this dose is generally given for a 1 to 2 days, and the dose that is required in 24 hours is given as a fixed dose reduction for the next period of 7 to 10 days. There's something called as front loading also, which is very infrequently used, should not be used for OP-based care, where a big dose of diazepam or lorazepam is given initially, a patient is monitored every 2 to 3 hours, and at the end of 6 hours, if the patient still has withdrawal symptoms, another dose is repeated, and again the monitoring process is repeated. Now, in case of front loading, it is the concept is that when you give a lot of a high dose of diazepam, the diazepam gets redistributed in the fat in the body and auto tapers itself, that further doses of diazepam may not be required. However, this is very infrequently practiced nowadays. So these are the various kind of detox regimens. This is a general plan of, or algorithmic plan of, how do you manage a patient who comes with symptoms of tremulousness or insomnia, that is symptoms of simple withdrawal. You should first ask if there is related to alcohol. If it is yes, you should also conduct a detailed physical examination, looking at various instruments like SIVA AR. You should also look at various other symptoms of head trauma, infections, hepatic disease or GI bleed, or any other coagulopathies that are there. Concomitant use of other drugs is very important to look at. You should also have a thorough neurological examination, as well as examination of the laboratory assessments, which have been already discussed in so many detail. You should also look at LFT, RFT, hematological examinations. Imaging is something that is very commonly done, mainly in cases of severe withdrawal. Mental status evaluation to look for how the level of consciousness, orientation, agitation, any other psychotic symptoms, as well as problems like violence, impending violence, or impending suicidal ideations. Now, if there is no major medical comorbidity, they can be managed on OP basis. However, if any of these parameters are deranged or you feel that a patient is high risk, he should be managed as inpatient. General measures is if there is a high risk situation or medical comorbidities, you should assess vitals and make sure of the ABC of the vitals. That is, you should monitor airways, make sure that the dehydration is controlled, corrected. If there is any electrolyte imbalance, we should correct that. As I mentioned before, thiamine, high dose thiamine can also be considered, as well as a nutritious diet, because many of the patients with alcohol abuse also have very poor oral intake. Specific measures, as I talked about earlier, are detoxification regimes. Generally considered agents are diazepam and lorazepam. Usual adult dose of diazepam can be up to 60 milligrams. The tablets that are available, 2 milligrams, 5 milligrams, and 10 milligrams, which is generally a safe agent, except for a patient with severe liver disease, where lorazepam is an agent of choice along with oxazepam. As I told earlier, roughly 1 unit of alcohol is equivalent to 1 milligram of lorazepam, which is almost equivalent to 5 to 10 milligram of diazepam. Symptomatic treatment is generally preferred in case of inpatient management, along with management of other medical problems. Educating patients and patients' family members about withdrawal symptoms and further how to expect future withdrawal symptoms is one of the part of managing of withdrawal symptoms. You should also advise not to use benzodiazepines and other substances like alcohol concomitantly. You should advise the patient in case of OP, follow up after 1 week, or in case of other high-risk situations, even earlier. We should also care to be taken that a patient should not be driving vehicles while on such sedatives, should not work at high-risk places or with heavy machinery, as well as should not drink when he's taking the medications. Final slide, this is always remember that detoxification is just the start of the treatment and not the end and all of the treatment. Craving management and relapse prevention is much bigger and much elaborate strategy to stop the alcohol use. Psychosocial interventions focusing on enhancement of social support of the family as well as patient is also important. And looking at the consequences as well as psychopathology of the alcohol withdrawal, it is also important to manage the vulnerabilities of the patient as to why the patient started alcohol use in the first place and managing that. Thank you very much.